Brachot Perek Tet, Mishnah Gimel. We'll continue our discussion. The Mishnah continues the study of the Brachot of Shehechiyanu, and then a number of other Brachot as well. So, says the Mishnah, Bana Bayit Chadash, V'kana Kelim Chadashim. If a person built a new house or bought new vessels, new Kelim, so it's not just clothes, but any Kelim. I would say nowadays, the best example I can think of is probably a cell phone. Because it gives you a certain amount of joy. Omer Baruch Shehechiyanu Lazman Hazeh. Our context and our language and our nusach today, the language is Shehechiyanu Baruch Ata Hashem Elokeinu Melech Haolam Shehechiyanu V'kiyimanu V'hiyanu Lazman Hazeh. Okay? So, that, and yesterday we also discussed, we mentioned that there's a difference between the bracha of Shehechiyanu and the bracha that we had yesterday of Hatov V'Hameitiv. Okay? We had the, on Shamim B'Sarot Tovot, you say Baruch Hatov V'Hameitiv. Interestingly, it's not just B'sarot Tovot, it's actually something much more tangible. So we said the difference between Hatov V'Hameitiv and Shehechiyanu is that Hatov V'Hameitiv is Hatov on me and V'Hameitiv for somebody else. So if it's a benefit from more than one person, this is something I just wanted to bring to you from Rav Malabed in Pidinei Halacha. He writes, Shtei brachot tiknu chachamim al dvarim chadashim u'misamchim. The sages instituted two brachot for things that bring joy. Things that are new and bring joy. One is Shehechiyanu V'kiyimanu V'hiyanu Lazman Hazeh. V'ashniya, and the second is Baruch Ata Hashem Elokeinu Melech Haolam Hatov V'Hameitiv. Ha'evdel b'neihem, the difference is Shekasher Asimcha Sheyechet Le'Adam Echad Brachato Shehechiyanu. Ulam, when it's for one person, the bracha is Shehechiyanu. But Kasher Asimcha Meshutefet L'Shnei Anashim, if it's for a partner joy for two or more, the joy is greater, then the bracha is the tov v'hameitiv. The connotation is that tov li, good for me, v'hameitiv l'acherim, and it's good for others. For example, b'nei zug shekonim la'atzman rihitim, if a couple buys furniture, or like a chair, a table, etc., etc., since they enjoy it together, they make the bracha of hatov v'hameitiv. Aval adam boded, but a single person, a person alone, shekana la'atzmo otam rihitim, but if an individual buys the same furniture, then his bracha is Shehechiyanu. Rabbi Lamed also says, he also notes, you can see here on his website, there's like a whole different, he says, something very interesting. He says, there's another difference between Shehechiyanu and Hatov V'Hameitiv. He says that Hatov V'Hameitiv is al tova mucheshet, something tangible, like a new house, a new clothes, or some wine that you drink, additional wine. It's more general. If you find some good news, something very, very exciting, if you have a great tidings, you could say a bracha of Shehechiyanu. It's interesting to note that nowadays, most people, they don't recite these brachot unless it's like really tangible, specific in the context of the Shulchan Aruch writes, then you say the bracha. We're very leery about saying unwarranted or what we consider inappropriate brachot. But if we think about it really, the idea that the Chazal, that the brachot were there to institute for, it's institute for us, sorry about that, the Chazal instituted these brachot in order to give us this sense and this understanding that we're supposed to have a spirit, have a sense of religiosity and a sense of thanks to God and things that happen in our lives. And that's something that I think is a little bit lost nowadays. We lost that sense of the spirituality of the brachot and having the sense of spontaneous thanks to God when good things happen. That brings us to the next topic. The Mishnah says, "Mevarech ala ra'a me'ein ala tova, ve'al ha'tova me'ein ala ra'a." Remember, we said the bracha is ra'a. There's a bracha for bad things of Baruch Dayan Emet, and there's also a bracha of Shehechiyanu. So, what happens if the Kahati says, "What happens if the bad thing brings about good?" Bracha me'ein ala tova. Okay, so if it's Dayan Emet, let's say, God forbid, a person loses a loved one. So you say Dayan Emet, but then that loved one left you $80 million. Ugh. Do you say Dayan Emet? So the Mishnah says, yes, you make the bracha, even it's bad for you now, so therefore you make the bracha of Hatov V'Hameitiv, of Dayan Emet, even though it's Me'ein Al HaTovah. It's going to bring about good. Same thing is true if you have good news, Sheme'ein Al HaRa'ah. Okay, so if you find something, right, if you find something now, but if you find this, I don't know, let's say you win the lottery. That's good news. But you know in the end that all lottery winners end up broke and hating their entire family, which actually happens to be generally true, which raises the question of why people want to win lottery so badly. But you won the lottery. You won $200 million. So it's good now, even though you know ultimately it's going to ruin your life. Nonetheless, you make the bracha of Shechianu Atov Ve'Meitiv, even though you're going to regret it later on. Mishnah goes on to another topic entirely. Hatzoek l'sheavar, harezo tfilat shav. If you cry out about the past, this is a wasteful tfilah. Ketzad, what's the example? Haita ishto me'uberet ve'amar, yihi ratzon shetelet ishti zachar, if their wife is pregnant. And he says, let it be your will, let it be your will. God, please let it be a boy. Harezo tfilat shav. That's a wasteful tefillah. Why? Because the child is either a boy or a girl. The sex is already determined. This is I'm not going to get into this now, but it raises a fascinating midrash about the notion that when Leah was pregnant with her last child and she had Dinah, she prayed to switch the sex of the child. That has ramifications for different kinds of modern day births, specifically for surrogates. If you're interested, you can look into it. Nonetheless, that would be a miracle. So to switch the sex of the baby would be a miracle. We don't pray for miracles. If you wanted to have a male child, or a female child, for that matter, you have to pray before your wife conceives, not after. Similarly, if you're going on the road, and you hear cries out in the city, i.e., terrible things are happening, I hope it's not my family. God, please not deliver me. That's a tefillat shava. Rezu tefillat shava. That's a wasteful prayer because it was what it was. If you say, God, I wish you should help the people that are in distress. If you say, you know, I hope they have a speedy recovery. That's one thing. But to say, I hope it's not me, that's not an appropriate prayer because that's already too late. And the very fascinating, the Shulchan Aruch says that you're allowed to pray. Not sure, I don't know if it's the Shulchan Aruch, but the sources bring down. If you're about to, in your grain, in your storehouse, before you count, even though your grain has already been harvested, before you count, you still can pray that it should be a great number. It should be a good harvest. After you count, you can't pray. I.e., it's a tefillat shav after it's already been counted. Even though the harvest has already been harvested, it's a very interesting paradox in what brings about bracha and whether counting brings about bracha or not. I want to dedicate this learning to the memory of my father, Rav Simcha ben Yitzchak Kalman, and I wish everyone a great day. If you have any comments or questions, please feel free to contact me, rspolter@gmail.com.